Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, meanwhile, calls on President Marcos to veto the Maharlika Investment Fund bill. That way, he says, lawmakers can again scrutinize the bill. For Pimentel, in its current form, the Maharlika Fund bill is rushed and its purpose remains vague.
Maganda siguro, i-veto na lang niya yan para ibalik ulit sa House tsaka sa Senate. At least, binibigyan niya ng mas matagal na panahon na mapag-aralan niya ang Maharlika Investment Fund. Hindi dumaan ito sa normal na proseso kasi pinagsama sa isang araw yung second and third reading. Kasi nga may presidential certification. Pero ang sabi naman ng Constitution, pati yung presidente natin, guided siya dun sa sinabi ng Constitution na kailangan merong public calamity or emergency na kayang solusyonan itong panukalang batas na ito. Ano naman yun, di ba? Ano naman yung bakit ba ito minadali?
An economist from UP Los Baños echoes Senator Pimentel's sentiment on the Maharlika Investment Fund. Professor Enrico Villanueva says there's still confusion over what kind of fund it is and its purpose.
There's still confusion up to now about what it should be. So the fund has been relabeled from a wealth fund in recognition of the lack of surplus of the Philippines to an investment fund. And yet, the way the declaration of policy is worded is still confused, acting like a social wealth fund. And even the functions of the Maharlika Investment Corporation, there are about five or six in the list. These are all pertaining to financial investing. And financial investing is the thing that you do with a surplus coming from a social wealth fund. So not much on development.
He adds, there are also provisions that appear to go against the law, particularly in funding sources, compromising state-owned and controlled banks, and even the central bank's capital adequacy.
They're toying with the capitalization of the bank. It means that there's some sort of interference on the BSP thing. It's good that they've at least they're no longer talking about tinkering with the international reserves. And I guess that's the reason why Governor Medalla is kind of okay with it. This is a lesser evil, if you look at it. Uh-huh. But still, you cannot have, it's embarrassing, it's impractical, it's almost scary to have a central bank with only 50 billion capital.
Challenging the Maharlika Investment Fund bill before the Supreme Court may be a futile effort for now. That's according to Albay Representative Ed Selagman. The lawmaker believes there's no constitutional issue in Congress's approval of the controversial measure.
Yung timeliness ay hindi constitutional issue yan.
Mm-hmm.
Yung wala tayong sapat na pundo o wala tayong sovereign wealth ay hindi constitutional issue yan. And sabi ng Korte Suprema, ang batas ay pinasa according to the wisdom of the Congress. And yung wisdom ay hindi pwedeng i-question. Sa ngayon, premature pa ang pag-file ng petition questioning its constitutionality sapagkat hindi pa ito batas, hindi pa ito napipirma ng ating Pangulo.
Former lawmaker Teddy Casino agrees, but the former Bayanmuna representative says the speedy passage of the bill remains questionable. Bayanmuna has a pending motion of reconsideration pending before the High Court over its dismissed petition challenging the swift approval of the bill at the lower house. Casino says they will also consider questioning the bill once President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. signs it into law. This, as he believes, safeguards placed in the measure are not enough.
Ang naging experience natin dyan bilang isang mambabatas, ang safeguards palagi nalulusutan eh.
Ala.
Bigyan kita ng example. Mm. Ang sabi nila, hindi magagamit ang pension funds. Hindi daw magagamit ang pondo ng GSIS, SSS, etc. True enough, nandun sa ilang provisions yun. Hindi pwede. Pero ang pinag-uusapan dun yung shares. Kumbaga, hindi pwede maging investor yung GSIS, SSS, PhilHealth, Pag-ibig, etc. Pero ang Maharlika Investment Corporation kasi is authorized to issue bonds. Ibig sabihin, pwede siyang mangutang by issuing bonds. At hindi pinagbabawal ang GSIS, SSS, etc.
Okay,
na mabili ng bonds. Mm-hmm. So, bawal silang maging shareholders, maging investors, pero hindi sila bawal maging creditor. Mm. At ito yung pwede mangyari. Okay, hindi nga investor sila, pero pera pa rin ng pensioners ang gagamitin sa pagpapautang. Napakalaking posibilidad ng pagwaldas at pagnanakaw sa kabangyaman. Mm-hmm. Because remember, itong investment fund na ito, this is a super investment fund. 500 billion ang pinag-uusapan na.
A possible conspiracy. That's how Philippine Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla describes the sudden recantation of 10 suspects in the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo. The suspects had alleged they were tortured by law enforcement agents into linking suspended lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. to the crime. While Remulla has ordered a probe into those allegations, he doubts the veracity of those claims.
Pero ito, tatanungin ko sa inyo. Bakit gusto nilang maiwan sa NBI kung tinocho sila sa NBI? I'll ask you that. Kung talagang tinocho sila sa NBI, ba't gusto nilang maiwan sa NBI? Ba't ayaw nilang malipat sa labas, palabas sa NBI? So is that consistent with somebody who was tortured in that place? No, it's an afterthought. It's a cover-up. It shows a conspiracy among the 10 of them that they were really part of the conspiracy when all of them suddenly recant.
Remulla insists the prosecution has enough evidence to go forward with the case despite the recantations. He even says they will use the supposed conspiracy to bolster their terrorism case against Teves and his group.
There's a conspiracy to cover up this crime, this terrorism that happened in our country, which we cannot countenance and we cannot stand for. The recantations are being spoken of as if they were gospel, that they would be so heavy in evidence. Parang gospel truth na. Pero ang lumalabas kasi dyan. If you look at your jurisprudence through the hundreds of years that recantations have been talked about by all the courts throughout the world, recantations are frowned upon by the courts. There's an issue of perjury, sabihin natin, for sure. Ayun ang sigurado, not reasonable doubt.
A journalists group calling on media practitioners to monitor closely the killing of radio broadcaster Christian Shalo Bundukin. This, as the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines says, his death proves there are still threats to the lives of journalists. The NUJP also reiterated its call to the government to put an end to attacks on media practitioners.
Ituloy pa rin. Kumbaga, sinabi naman na ng pamahalaan na they respect yung role of media in society, you know, in nation building. So, tuloy natin to at isa sa pinakamalaking paraan para ipakita na pinangangalagaan nga ang mga mamahayag ay yung to hold these people to account, yung mga umatake sa atin, yung mga nangahara sa atin, or in this case, yung mga outright pinapatay yung mga kasama natin.
Bundukin, a journalist from Oriental Mindoro who had been outspoken about the oil spill in the province, was shot dead early Wednesday by two motorcycle-riding gunmen. One of the assailants was killed after being hit by a car by Bundukin's son, while the other managed to escape. A manhunt is currently underway to locate the suspect.
Mayroon po tayong mga nakuha na mga picture doon sa loob ng U-box ng ginamit na motor. At yun nga po, ayun ang sinusugan natin at pinaloob natin kung saan siya nakatira. Sa lahat ng pinupuntahan niya at pinagtanong-tanong din natin, wala na dun sa lugar. Hindi na natin makita. Talagang nagtatago eh.
Former and current officials of the Light Rail Transit Authority are facing criminal and administrative charges over alleged anomalous maintenance contracts on the LRT Line 2 system. Included in the complaint filed by lawyer Jerry Francisco are current administrator Hernando Cabrera, and former administrator Jeremy Rehino, as well as officials of a South Korean firm. Francisco alleges the respondents conspired to defraud the government by using what he described as imaginary scenarios to conduct upgrade works. This, he says, led to the government losing about 247 million pesos in 301 days. One of the accused, Rehino, denied the allegation, insisting he had no participation in the contract. The National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council, or NDRRMC, says Typhoon Betty's damage to infrastructure and agriculture was very minimal, but it says around 77,000 individuals were affected by the storm.
We will continue to enhance our preparation by making sure that we have enough stockpile of food and non-food items that will be placed in our strategic warehouses throughout the country. So we will continue to do that. And at the same time, we will continue to enhance the capacities of our response unit down to the local government units.
Typhoon Betty left the Philippines Thursday afternoon, but State Weather Bureau Pagasa warned it may still continue to enhance the southwest monsoon. A tech expert says artificial intelligence plays a part in creating a more secure environment for digital payment transactions. This amid rising scamming incidents in the country, including the GCash phishing attack last month. Michael Calma says the GCash incident exposed the need to educate the public on cybersecurity as well as the vulnerability of SMS as a means of two-factor authentication. This, as he says, is where AI-powered tools come in.
It really starts with knowing the customer. So it starts with EKYC, electronic know your customer. Your ID is scanned. The many Philippine IDs that we have, there's a liveness check to ensure that you are a live person. And then there's face comparison, where the selfie of the applicant, the bank account applicant, is compared to the ID that they issue. Now, more important after that is, how does the bank or fintech know that the one transacting is actually the account owner? And this is where face biometrics comes in. All in all, and in conjunction with other security measures, this will help create a more secure environment for our consumers to transact.